I'm here in Frankenmuth, Michigan, along the Cass River at the site of the old Frankenmuth Dam. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Built in 1848 originally, the dam here was originally built of piled up rocks covered in dirt. Not the greatest dam in the world, although it was very common at the time. This was actually later converted over to a wooden dam, which was more common at the time. Still not the strongest dam in the world. In 1925, that actually got switched over to a concrete dam. The concrete dam lasted until fairly recently when it was removed. Let's take a walk up this levee here and we can talk about what we have here. So we're now at the bottom of the rock ramp. This was constructed in 2014 and 2015, along with the removal of the original dam. Rock ramps are basically artificial rapids. These are constructed out of concrete and stone. In this case, it's 25,000 tons of stone was used to create this ramp. Now, unlike the dam, rock ramps are pretty stable. There's just nowhere for them to really fail to. And because of that, this is considered a little safer, a little more long-term, but it has some other benefits as well. One of the biggest benefits, of course, is unlike dams, this actually allows for fish to migrate upriver. You may not think that's a big deal in some areas, but actually in this case, allowing the fish to migrate upriver opens 73 more miles of river habitat on the Cass River, a river that's commonly used by walleye and lake sturgeon, which are prized fish in the area. Now, there's some other challenges when you remove a dam. I mentioned the upriver part isn't really a reservoir so much as just a deeper part of the river built in here between the banks, one of those banks being an artificial levee. Well, one of the challenges when you do that is you do have to try to manage flooding, and flooding's always been an issue here. There have been a number of floods that did serious damage in town. By building the levees, that mostly eliminated the flooding risk. However, it created another problem, which is that you just flooded somewhere else, which is what typically happens in these cases. When you build levees to control flooding in one area, the water has to just go somewhere else. Before we go upriver, let's take a look at these rapids. And you can see they don't exactly look like natural rapids, but from the water flow point of view, they actually do a really good job. So this does actually pretty closely approximate natural rapids. And if you're a fish, this is perfect. Let's head upriver a bit farther and see what we can see. Now you might be wondering why I'm not talking about the mill over here on the left side of the river. And the answer, quite simply, is it's a fake. It's a modern reproduction. This was built fairly recently. The idea was to add another tourist attraction to the city of Frankenmuth, which is already pretty tourist heavy. The mill itself was originally operational, and it's in the location of an original grist mill, but it's a completely modern reproduction. It's not currently operational, it's currently in the process actually of being remodeled as a high-end suite hotel. I believe the last I saw there were going to be just four rooms to it, four suites. So as you look across the river, you see that the rapids, which looked a little more natural down below, are built in a number of very distinct steps. These steps all have pools behind them, which make it easier for the fish to migrate up. Also eliminates any of the large drops that you would have otherwise had here. Let's keep going upriver. trail we're walking on is built along the side of the levee. The levee was constructed here, as I mentioned, to control flooding. Flooding having been a major problem here. Well, they wanted to maintain that flood control and maybe even improve it some. So when they took the dam out, while still trying to maintain the water level in the upper part of the river, they had to make some changes. One of the changes they made was actually working with people upriver, and there's a golf course upriver of here, which voluntarily agreed to go in and lower the level of their golf course. And the reason they would do that is because that gives them a place to actually manage to give the water some place to go. So when the water comes up, you have to give it some place to go where it's going to overflow the bank somewhere. So if you can control where it overflows, that's usually to your advantage. And that's what they did at this golf course. Instead of being built up higher to make sure it doesn't flood, which originally was, they actually lowered it so if the water levels go up, the water will intentionally flood onto this golf course. And by intentionally flooding onto the golf course, that actually prevents flooding elsewhere where it's less desirable. Across the river, you see a yellow dock area over here. They actually run commercial boat tours from there when things are a little warmer. And those run from just above the old dam site up the Cass River quite a ways. As I mentioned, it is a big tourist area here. One of the things that they were able to do along with the dam removal is add this great walkway in here. So you have a walk along the river, you have better flood control after the dam removal. They were able to maintain the water levels above here, still control the flooding upriver with the use of these dikes, but manage it a little bit better with the changes to the golf course. You see a replica covered wooden bridge that was built. I think this was built, I think in the 70s they built this. It was built in part as a historic site, in part, or as a historic replica site, and in part as a way to provide access to more parking on the other side of the river here. Because, as I said, this is a big tourist area here, and they needed the extra parking. So to come around this bend, you can really see the levee build up over here on the left side of the river. The right side is a little bit lower, over towards the hotel over there. But the left side, very, very clearly built up as a levee all the way upriver here. Now that's not necessarily a bad thing. It does prevent the flooding over there. And you'll notice the low area over towards the right, towards the hotel. The hotel's built up on a hill. We have the low grassy area, which intentionally allows flooding. Beyond it, you see some stands there for sports fields. Again, those are built low, which allows flooding to happen. And if you look at what's up ahead here on the trail, you can see that flooding does happen here. The water's receded back down. This is pretty much normal levels here right now. So this goes up quite a ways. We're going to go ahead and turn around here. Let's head back downriver. You get a nice shot of the covered wooden bridge here in Frankenmuth. managed to get in some of the flood control efforts here. We have the concrete walkway with the concrete lined slope down in this narrow area. On the far side, you have heavily built up stone. It's all just to manage floods, try to minimize the damage that comes from them. Bit of history here, perhaps, if we can zoom in. You see on the center column there, you have the dam ahead 300 feet sign from when there was a dam ahead. And then to the right of it, you have the rapids ahead sign. Hear the music in the background. We are right in the middle of downtown Frankenmuth here. Very Bavarian themed town. So I was not able to find a lot of information about the mills here in Frankenmuth. Again, they're local mills. There's a brewery here that was the last user of the mill here. Originally, like most small towns, sawmill and a grist mill. Chances are the sawmill was first, provide lumber for people to actually build the town, followed by the grist mill. Today, as I said, there's a reproduction of a mill here. And at one point that was open and operational, but that one didn't last very long. They eventually rented out the first floor as a gift shop, and later as a coffee shop. And now, as I said, it's being rebuilt in its interior as a luxury suite motel. But back to the rapids. This is a serious option for dam removal. It doesn't look quite like the return to nature that we saw with the dam removal over on Dexter's Mill Creek. Check out the link in the video, in the video description, if you want to see that video. But it's another valid option. This returns the ability for fish migration, brings the ecosystem much more back to where it was originally, and creates a far healthier ecosystem, while in this case, fully preserving the upstream depth and the upstream recreation opportunities for boaters. So thousands, maybe tens of thousands of dams in the Industrial Revolution got us to where we are today. Without those dams, without the power they provided, the regional mills, even the local mills, would have never taken off, and we would not have everything that we have today as a result of the Industrial Revolution. Unfortunately, dams don't last forever, and dam removal is becoming a far more common thing. And it's really a far more common requirement. They're just not safe anymore. We know now how much habitat damage they can create, and as a result, these dams have to go. This is an example of one of the ways to do it. this was an example of one that's been very successful. It was done right. And with a little planning, taking your time, you can do it right. So while dam removal isn't exactly part of what created the Industrial Revolution, it's certainly something that happened as a definite result of the Industrial Revolution. And that's why these rapids are the Industrial Revolution. I do want to ask for some help. As you know, YouTube channels live and die on subscribers and likes. So if you are getting anything out of this video, out of this channel, you want to see more, please do hit the like button and subscribe. It doesn't cost anything. Hit notify, and if you can leave a comment also, more than 2-3 words, YouTube really uses that in the algorithm to decide, hey, there's interaction going on, this is a great channel, it's gonna show it to even more and more people. So that's the best way that you can help out the channel. Also, I do have a Patreon page at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. If you could help out there, memberships start at just a few bucks a month.